So I'm going to talk about digital humans. My name's Andy Wood. I'm the president of Motion, very well known in this field, but I'll explain more about that later. About a year ago, about 11 months ago, I did a TEDx talk in Los Angeles on this very subject. And what is fascinating is the amount of material I've been able to add in between now and then, because this field is going really rapidly, particularly my experience of the work that we do, but also what we see with others and what we see coming down the pipeline. So, for the sake of argument, we could look at the world as if digital humans already exist, and I'll try and emphasize that point as I'll talk through everything. So we're told that AI machines, digital characters, digital assistants, digital companions and robots can make our lives easier, better, more convenient. I don't know if that really is the case. But we already obtain our food, clothing, anything without even leaving our homes. The world has changed so much. And some of the big changes that we're experiencing now, I'll go through a few and we'll do so in the future. Science fiction is always a really great predictor. Modifier 1's just been mentioned, where people exist in a virtual reality world where they can be different species, different anything, different types of humans, different genders. Terminator, where robots are killing machines. Blade Runner, as humanoid sex workers. Westworld, where the humanoids rebel against the humans. Black Mirror, if you've seen the Ashley O. Miley Cyrus episode, you'll see some of the things that they took the inspiration from, as I explain you a bit of background. And then my favorite, 2001 A Space Odyssey, where the computer takes over the running of the spaceship from the human captain with a classic line. I'm sorry, Dave, I'm afraid I can't do that. So science fiction is a great predictor when the lines become blurred between the real world and machines. And scientists are privileged enough to work with a few, have already invented some prototype digital humans that have a greater realism than ever before. It's not good. Any idea why it's not really video? Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. We'll talk some of the videos and maybe go back to this. So let's see if this video on computer vision works. Here we go. So here the eyes being tracked. The dots are markers that are tracking the movement of the pupil, and every single nuance is collected. So they say the eyes are the window of the soul, and the face is the index of the mind. So again, they have very precise live real-time tracking here. And that's coupled with 360-degree scans of a real human being to create the digital character, which is then rigged with digital puppet strings in order to make the avatar move. We got the cubic motion, little by us, we're 10 years old, with strong ties to the University of Manchester and additional offices at Pinewood and Hollywood. And we've got a number about 20 PhD computer vision scientists who've been at the forefront of image analysis for a couple of decades. Large team, they could probably get to about 120 by the end of this year. And we've got a lot of animators and people in R&D. And I reckon we've processed more performance-driven animation than anywhere else on the planet. So the clients that we develop facial animation for is quite a prestigious list. And let me show you the first time we did some real-time live. I'm hoping the video is run on this thing. Th- This was at GDC in San Francisco in 2016. So again, I don't know why the videos aren't playing. So what you're seeing here, I don't know what's happening with the sign, but it gives me more text to talk, is an attract sequence of the game Hellblade. It's displayed in a room full of 300 people and live streamed to over 100,000. Reality is a bit different. As you can see, there is actually an actress behind the curtain live driving the attract sequence there and then. So we drop the curtains and reveal to everybody. This was the first hyper-reality real-time digital human that had been presented before. Then I went on to win the real-time graphics award at SIGGRAPH 2016, and Hellblade itself won 5 BAFTAs. Our scientists weren't content to stop there, so a year later we went on and developed Mount. So this is based on the FX guy journalist Mike Seymour, but this is all the digital version of him. He appeared in real time where he had mounted camera and interviewed people live on stage, stating like this one. Again, all in real time. So the camera is tracking his movement along the stage. He was behind the screen. On the stage, you could see this representation of it, which was pretty incredible. So this was a partnership with Epic and through Lateral in order to generate the rig of Mike and get the readers involved all in real time at over 60 frames a second. So the video I tried to run before is a Siren. Siren was a project that Keep Motion again did with 3Lateral at Epic and Next Studios from Tencent. She's a digital double of a Chinese actress. And again, everything you see was created in real time. So you can see the actress again wearing a head-mounted camera. And as she moves, this was taken live from a presentation we did, so the avatar moves. And not only can you live with one actress, anybody can be anybody at any time. So this is actually the digital double Siren. And in case you were wondering, the non-human Siren is the one in the red dress. But just to pause the thought, in terms of the speed and accuracy, many of performance-driven animation. This is an interesting stat that somebody gave me. 21 studios and over 2,600 CG artists to produce the CGI in the Game of Thrones series. So an awful lot of people for a process that can become more accurate and automated. If you go on a little bit, Cubic Motion have now developed these tools available for license for people to develop characters in real time for Persona. And we've started to develop the tools so that people can use them within and on the outside of head mounted display. This is an example of a Vive. You can see the eyes being tracked inside. And then we can also track externally so that the AR world and VR worlds are getting more and more immersive. We've just built this shot was taken last week on a MoCap studio to do live broadcasts. We've got a couple of examples that we've been doing recently. In terms of the future, well, we see synthetic humans in films and games, and the realism and fidelity is increasing all the time. And in the future, I think we'll all have our own digital doubles that will behave as we want them to, emoting and expressing themselves as we want them to, or different way. Because we can record, we can create by text to animation, all sorts of different personas for ourselves. And they can be tuned and beautified and modified. So it took 3 hours to scan with the technical specs off, but that was something done for me a couple of years ago in Serbia at the National Biathlon. But in the future, we'll see doctors and counsellors commonplace interaction with all sorts of different digital credible humans. This is an interesting statistic. In Japan, a survey of Japanese people between 18 and 34 found that almost 70% of unmarried men, 60% of women are not in a relationship. This is quite an interesting video. If it runs. No idea why the video is not running, but I'm quite prepared to hand over links to all these things so you can see for yourself. But what this does feature is, oh, there you go, it's running. So without sound, but this just gives you a brief insight onto digital companions that are prevalent in Japan now. She has a very squeaky, high-pitched voice. And it's underlaid by a romantic music. Scary. And then the is that one person will be able to control many digital humans, and many will be able to control one. So things like customer services can be developed where you have a team of people all acting as one person, probably with a synthesized voice. I think it's challenging enough with consumer services, but this takes it to a new level. So, in summary, digital humans, they never tire, they can be adapted to suit any purpose or audience, they don't need paying, they can be upgraded and evolved, and they perform perfectly over and over again. They can be as smart or as dumb as you like, and they don't get sick, they don't get drunk, and they don't get hangovers. So, just to look at it on a different level, this is a robot that I met with last year, named Sophia. She's made by Hanson Robotics, and she's already a citizen of the world in Saudi Arabia, and she's spoken to the United Nations, and this is before computer vision runs her hand. One of the benefits of doing these speeches and talks is you get to speak with many really good people. And I was at an event in Switzerland a couple of months ago where ILM presented their work on Avengers. And I think this modelling of the Hulk is really fantastic. Slightly different techniques where they hand draw the eyes, but I really think this is pushing the boundaries further again. As is this work from NPC, there's a very good commercial that takes place every Christmas in the UK for the brand John Lewis, and this time we used Elton John. And even though I'm used to all this stuff, I was really surprised to see that Elton John himself only appeared within the advert at his current age, and they made a model of him and inserted it in templates of the square footage. Then, if you get into the world of deep fake, this has really kind of started to accelerate this year in my experience. This is a normal little example of how people can bring the Mona Lisa to life. And then, this is quite unnerving, really. Again, if you type in The Shining or Jim Carrey, The Shining, you can see this in rather powerful audio as well online. But I mean, that's pretty convincing. All a bit shocking, really. This is a new app which has been launched in China about 3 weeks ago. It's called Zao. Essentially, you take one or two photographs of yourself and upload them to the app. And in this example, just a normal guy has been superimposed in a lot of Leo DiCaprio films. It's been a new campaign recently for malaria with David Beckham. And what's happened here is that they've translated his voice into different languages. So they've sampled lots of different people's voices, and then they've remasked David Beckham, who you can see here, to just his lips so he can speak in any tone. So that's what some of the other people in this field are doing. To get back to things I know about, this is a company that I advise based out of LA called WIF, and they focus in the market of retrospective product placement or targeted product placement that could be by brand, by country. So you can see here, let's imagine it's a part of the world where Pepsi isn't a particularly big brand, but Coca-Cola is. You can just switch them out. I think it's a George Orwell expression. He controls the past, can control the future. It's all a little bit disturbing. In terms of the ad market and repurposing historic footage with all the subscription video on demand TV channels, it's yet another revenue stream. And computer vision is becoming prevalent everywhere. This I just picked up on recently while I was doing some research for this talk. And in China, people are now paying with their faces. So you identify yourself. I mean, lots of us have these things, and the information we give up, this aspect of scanning, and I use it, is quite remarkable, really, in terms of information we're prepared to share, give away, and be used. Convenient, yes, but it does make you wonder how deep all this is going to go. And we quickly go to the world of virtual celebrities. You can see there's a series on the top line there of those that have over a million followers. But Cupid Motion, we've done some work with Michaela here, who's like a virtual YouTube celebrity. She's also produced and interviewed people at the Coachella Festival. She's had a couple of singles. She can also do real-time performance driven, so she can communicate as if she existed. Real-time live. This is something we worked on with Riot Games in China. It was 3 weeks ago where we brought a key character from League of Legends to light, and this was live streamed in front of Dubai, 100 million people. What you can see there is the presenter is a real human being in the real auditorium, and then the virtual character is projected next to her and interviewed in real time as if she was there. And getting lots of feedback from the audience there. As I said, 100 million live streams. So the future, just to summarize, video games, this performance-driven animation accelerates the turnaround. You've seen some of the live broadcasts. You've seen lots of stuff where it's emergent for CG actors and characters. TV, so much episodic content is required now Apple and Disney and all those competing challenges in that market, this is a very quick way to create material. Esports is immense. We talked about VR and AR. Holograms, concerts, digital companions and assistants, the world of education. It goes on and on. Of course, all I can show you in terms of what we're doing in Cubic Motion is what we've put out there. It all remains kind of confidential until it's released to the world. So you've just seen what we did with Riot 3 weeks ago. The stuff that we've got in the pipeline is even more mind-blowing than what I've been able to show you. So digital humans, I think there is an argument that they're telepresent and omnipresent and that they already exist. Whether we become digital humans, being scanned to go shopping, or whether we real-time live guide people or interact with them, it's a full 360.